Welcome students, I hope all of you are doing well. We will continue our learning in the subject of smart grids and electric vehicles in the aspect of electric vehicles. We will be looking into the sub-module 3 of unit 3, that is electric drive trains. In previous lecture, we discussed the fundamentals of a typical automotive vehicle operation with mathematical formulations describing a vehicle's behavior based on the principles of mechanics, and looked into the detailed analysis in terms of the vehicle's performance as well. Both propulsion and braking was discussed. In today's lecture, we will be going over the main difference between an electric vehicle and a conventional internal combustion engine based vehicle. To start, because once we get that, everything else will be easy to understand. Then we will look into the architecture of designing an electric vehicle, introduce ourselves to the concept of hybrid electric vehicles, and look into the different configurations and classifications for the hybrid electric vehicles. In essence, there are two fundamental characteristics that all passenger four-wheelers have that we need to understand here. The first fundamental is energy storage. And the second fundamental is motor. Let's start with motor. We all know that a typical motor is a equipment, is a device that converts the potential energy into kinetic energy. The potential energy is converted into kinetic energy when it comes to a motor. In an internal combustion engine, ICE, motor is a heat engine, and for an electric vehicle, we shall regard the engine as an electrical engine. An electric engine fundamentally works using magnetic fields. As you must have all know about the electric motor principle, you must have studied in your first year of elements of electrical engineering, where it's a simple concept where you take a coil of wire, and if electricity is made to flow through it, the wire gets magnetized, the coil of wire gets magnetized. And if we place this magnetic coil between the two other magnets, one side of the coil will be pushed up and the other side of the coil will be pushed down, creating a rotary motion. This makes the coil turn until it is vertical, and at that moment we quickly change the polarity, and this process keeps going on. When it comes to energy storage, for an internal combustion engine, the energy is stored by means of a fuel, which in turn is stored in a CC tank. Whereas an electric vehicle, the fuel is electricity in nature. So the storage part is used by the means of a battery. Now let us look into operation of an heat engine. In a heat engine, burning releases the potential energy in a fuel. This heat produces expansion, and this in turn drives some mostly rotary motion. This is true for steam engines, Stirling engines, diesel engines, and gasoline engines. The animation which you are seeing shows how a four-stroke engine works. This is basically a modern gasoline engine which was invented over 100-150 years ago. On the first stroke, gasoline is injected into a chamber by opening a valve that is then closed again. On the second stroke, the cylinder moves upwards and the gasoline is compressed. On the third stroke, the energy in the fuel is harvested by igniting it. This is where we get the energy out of the gasoline. The resulting explosion drives the cylinder down, and that produces a rotating motion. This is comparable to a bicycle basically, where pushing down the pedal moves the bicycle forward. On the fourth and final stroke, the energy burned, that is the gasoline which is being burned, is emitted. It's all very ingenious, but it has quite a few problems. The entire heat engine requires hundreds of precisely crafted moving parts, as you could have seen from the animation in the previous slide. This makes the engine heavy and also expensive. And since all the heat and explosions cause a lot of wear and tear, high maintenance is required, and even then there are chances of wearing down. It is this part of the internal combustion engine vehicle that is worn down the earliest. The heat engine of internal combustion engine also wastes a lot of energy. In theory, the efficiency can be improved to about 50% theoretically, but that would mean a couple of things that are needed to be done. Firstly, the engine would become more expensive. Secondly, it would have to run at an almost constant number of explosions per minute, which is very hard practically. And finally, the motor should be operated at almost maximum power at all the times of operation. In practice, even though we have been improving the internal combustion engine for more than 100 years now, a regular ICE vehicle wastes more than 75% of the energy it consumes as heat. For health and climate change, the biggest problem is exhaust fumes. The first problem is that they are unhealthy, which we all know. But the biggest problem is that burning 1 liter of gasoline produces around 2.3 kilogram of CO2 gas. Now, if we compare these characteristics with an electrical engine, electric motor has numerous advantages. It has only one moving part. We call that rotor. Therefore, the whole engine can be relatively light, compact, and inexpensive. And since magnetic fields are very gentle, an electric motor can last essentially forever without any maintenance, as compared to ICE heat engine. Energy efficiency, which is one of the major part that has led to smart grids, renewable energy systems, and electric vehicles. Energy efficiency can be close to around 99 to 100%, and we can win back energy during the braking process. So theoretically, it takes you over around 100% if we compare it to the gasoline engine, which is only 25 to 26% efficient. Because of this, the average electric vehicle is 4 times more efficient than an average conventional ICE vehicle. And if we compare sports car, the electric car is up to 20 times more efficient. So oversizing an electric engine does not materially reduce efficiency, and the engines are cheap and light. That's one reason why in practice electric vehicles can accelerate much faster. They simply have much bigger engines, and there is no downside to that. For health and climate, the biggest advantage is pretty clear. It can run on renewable energy, and the motor itself has zero emissions. Thus, it can be deduced that under all of the different aspects, it is clear that the electric motor, thereby the electric engine, is superior in every way. Now let's look into the thought here. I have been speaking a lot in comparison of electric engine and heat engine. If such is the case, then why did we end up with gasoline engine? See, in the last slide we looked into that there are the two fundamental characteristics. One is the engine part, motor part, and the other is the storage part. Why did we end up with a gasoline engine is because of energy storage. When we look at the motors, the electric engine has an upper hand. Yes, agreed. But if we look at energy storage, the heat engine has an upper hand because fuel, gasoline, can be stored in CC tanks, which is a really marvelous way to store energy. Batteries comparatively are poor. A lead acid battery, a traditional lead acid battery during the 1900s stored only around 0.01 kilowatt hour per kilogram. That's more than 1000 times less than gasoline. A lead acid battery at the end of the last millennium was better, and it gave around 0.035 kilowatt hour per kilogram, but that's also pretty worse as compared to the gasoline engines. A nickel metal hydride battery available at the turn of the new millennium stores about 0.08 kilowatt hour, which again is less. Now, with the advent of telecommunications, which we have seen in our daily life, lighter batteries are available for cell phones and laptops. And now a lithium battery as produced by the Tesla Gigafactory, for example, has about 0.25 kilowatt hour per kilogram. In the near future, maybe in the next decade, we can expect batteries that store double that, say 30 times worse. So theoretically, lithium-ion batteries can even hold more energy than gasoline, by the way. But this is very, very theoretical, what I'm talking about. So if we take the efficiency of the motor into account, we could have a theoretical situation where actually the batteries are lighter. But this is a very, very extravagant concept, and a large amount of research with industrial back has to be carried out. Previously, the electric vehicles were mainly converted from the existing internal combustion engine vehicle by replacing the ICE and fuel tank with an electric motor drive and battery pack while retaining all the other components as shown in the figure. Drawbacks were there, such as its heavy weight, lower flexibility, performance degradation. These drawbacks have caused the use of this type of electric vehicle, as you can see in the figure, to fade out. In replacement of this, a modern electric vehicle is built based on the original body and frame design. This satisfies the structure requirements unique to electric vehicles and makes use of the greater flexibility of electric propulsion. A modern electric drivetrain is conceptually illustrated here. In the figure, you can see that the drivetrain consists of three major subsystems. There are three major blocks, as you can see. The first block or the first subsystem is the electric propulsion subsystem, which comprises of the vehicle controller, power electronic converter, electric motor, mechanical transmission, and driving wheels. The energy source subsystem, the small rectangle below the electric propulsion subsystem, consists of the energy source, an energy management unit, and the energy refueling unit. The auxiliary subsystem, right side to the energy source subsystem block, consists of the power steering unit, the hotel climate control unit, and the auxiliary supply unit. Now, what happens is, as you can see in the upper side, there is brake and accelerator. Second figure, left side. Now, what happens is the driver uses brake and accelerator to control the vehicle along with the steering wheel. Based on the control inputs from the accelerator and brake pedals, the vehicle controller provides proper control signals to the electronic power converter in the electric propulsion subsystem. The converter functions to regulate the power flow between the electric motor and the energy source of the energy source subsystem. The backward power flow is due to the regenerative braking of the EV, and this regenerated energy can be restored into the energy source, provided the energy source is receptive. And that's why you have a dark black colored bi-directional arrow. Most EV batteries, as well as ultra capacitors and flywheels, readily possess the ability to accept regenerative energy. The energy management unit of the energy source subsystem cooperates with the vehicle controller to control the regenerative braking and its energy recovery. It also works with the energy refueling unit to control the refueling unit and monitor the usability of the energy source. The auxiliary power supply of the auxiliary subsystem provides the necessary power at different voltage levels for all the EV auxiliaries, especially the hotel climate control and the power steering units. There are a variety of possible EV configurations due to the variations in electric propulsion characteristics and the energy sources, which we introduce ourselves in the last slide. We shall discuss all these configurations one by one. Figure 1 shows the configuration of a first alternative or first classification, in which an electric propulsion replaces the IC engine of a conventional vehicle drivetrain. It consists of an electric motor, a clutch, a gearbox, and a differential. The clutch and gearbox may be replaced by an automatic transmission. The clutch is used to connect or disconnect the power of the electric motor from the driven wheels. The gearbox provides a set of gear ratios to modify the speed power or speed torque profile to match the load requirement. We studied this in previous lecture of vehicle propulsion. The differential in the figure is a mechanical device, usually a set of planetary gears, which enables the wheels of both sides to be driven at different speeds when the vehicle runs along a curved path. With an electric motor that has constant power in a long speed range, a fixed gearing can replace the multi-speed gearbox and reduce the need for clutch, as shown in the figure 2. This configuration not only reduces the size and weight of the mechanical transmission, it also simplifies the drivetrain control because gear shifting is not needed. Similar to this drivetrain, similar to the drivetrain of second figure, the electric motor, fixed gearing, and differential can be further integrated into a single assembly, while both axles point at both driving wheels. The whole drivetrain is further simplified and compacted. In figure 4, the mechanical differential is replaced by using two traction motors, as you can see, two M's. Each of them drives one side wheel and operates at different speed when the vehicle is running along a curved path. In order to simplify this drivetrain, the traction motor can be placed inside a wheel as shown in figure 5. This arrangement is the so-called in-wheel drive. A thin planetary gear set may be employed to reduce the motor speed and enhance the motor torque. The thin planetary gear set offers the advantage of a high speed reduction ratio as well as an inline arrangement of the input and output shaft. By fully abandoning any mechanical gearing between the electric motor and driving wheel, the out rotor of a low speed electric motor in the in-wheel drive can be directly connected to the driving wheel as shown in figure 6. Here, mechanical gearing is taken off. The speed control of the electric motor is equivalent to the control of the wheel speed and hence the vehicle speed. However, this arrangement requires the electric motor to have a very high torque to start and accelerate the vehicle. These were the possible EV configurations or architecture that were taken from this book. Moving further, we have already discussed in details the merits and limitations of IC vehicles and electric vehicles in previous slides when we compared through a tabular form. Now we will look into the basic concept and operating principles of hybrid electric vehicles, short form HEVs, powertrain. Now let us look what a powertrain should do. Any vehicle powertrain is required to develop sufficient power to meet the demands of vehicle performance, carry sufficient energy on board to support the vehicle while driving a sufficient range, demonstrate high efficiency, and emit few environmental pollutants. Broadly speaking, a vehicle may have more than one powertrain also. In that case, the powertrain is defined as the combination of the energy source and the energy converter or power source, such as the gasoline or diesel heat engine system, the hydrogen fuel cell electric motor system, and the chemical battery electric motor system, or so on, other configuration. A vehicle that has two or more powertrains is called as a hybrid vehicle. And a hybrid vehicle with an electrical powertrain is called as hybrid electric vehicle. The drivetrain of a vehicle is defined as the aggregation of all powertrains. A hybrid vehicle drivetrain usually consists of no more than two powertrains. More than two powertrains makes the drivetrain very complicated. To recapture the braking energy that is dissipated in the form of heat in conventional IC engine vehicles, a hybrid drivetrain usually has a powertrain that allows energy to flow bidirectionally. The other drivetrain is either bidirectional or unidirectional. Both the configurations are acceptable. The figure on the right side shows the concept of a hybrid drivetrain and the possible different power flow routes. A hybrid drivetrain can supply its power to the load by a selective powertrain. See, it has two powertrains, powertrain 1, powertrain 2. Every powertrain will have an energy source and an energy converter. Thus, there are two energy sources and two energy converters. One of the powertrains are electrical powertrains, making this as hybrid electric vehicle. There are many available patterns of operating these two powertrains to meet the load requirement. In pattern 1, the powertrain 1 alone delivers its power to the load. In this case, there is a hybridization with a gasoline diesel IC engine, which will be the powertrain 1, and a battery electric motor, which is powertrain 2. In this pattern, that is the pattern number 1, is the engine alone propelling mode. This may be used when the batteries are almost completely depleted and the engine has no remaining power to charge the batteries, or when the batteries have been fully charged and the engine is able to supply sufficient power to meet the power demands of the vehicle. Pattern 2. Powertrain 2 alone delivers its power to the load. This pattern is the pure electric propelling mode in which the engine is shut off. The IC engine is shut off. This pattern may be used for situation where the ICE cannot operate effectively, such as at very low speed or in areas where emissions are strictly prohibited. Now let us look at pattern number 3. Both powertrain 1 and powertrain 2 deliver their power to the load simultaneously. In this pattern number 3, the hybrid traction mode is there, and this mode, pattern number 3, may be used when high power is needed, such as during sharp acceleration or steep hill climbing. Pattern number 4, powertrain 2 obtains power from the load. This is the case of regenerative braking. The pattern number 4 is also called as the regenerative braking mode. Here, the kinetic or potential energy of the vehicle is recovered through the electric motor functioning as a generator. The recovered energy is then stored in the batteries to be reused later. Pattern number 5, powertrain 2 obtains power from powertrain 1. This pattern is the mode in which engine charges the batteries while the vehicle is at a standstill, coasting or descending on a slight grade in which no power goes into or comes from the load. Pattern number 6. Powertrain 2 obtains power from powertrain 1 and the load simultaneously. The pattern number 6 is the mode in which both regenerative braking and the IC engine charge the batteries simultaneously. Pattern number 7. Powertrain 1 delivers power to the load and to powertrain 2 simultaneously. Pattern number 7 is the mode in which engine propels the vehicle and charges the batteries simultaneously. Pattern number 8. Powertrain 1 delivers its power to the powertrain 2 and powertrain 2 delivers its power to the load. In this pattern, pattern number 8, the engine charges the batteries and the batteries supply power to the load. Now at last, we have pattern number 9 in which the powertrain 1 delivers its power to the load and the load delivers the power to powertrain 2. This pattern, pattern number 9, is the mode in which the power flows into the batteries from the heat engine through the vehicle mass. The typical configuration of this mode is that the two powertrains are separately mounted on the front and rear axles of the vehicle. Now, what I want all of you students is to, for every pattern, there are 9 patterns, I want you to draw the diagram, the right side diagram, with different arrow marks, solid arrow marks and the dashed arrow marks. Right? For every pattern, there will be different power flow while propelling, and for every pattern, there will be different power flow while charging the powertrain. These many patterns which you have seen offers abundant opportunity of making a hybrid vehicle. This creates much more flexibility over a single powertrain vehicle. So this is an advantage. With proper configuration and control, applying a specific mode for a special operating condition can potentially optimize the overall performance, efficiency, and CO2 emissions. However, in a practical design, deciding which mode would be implemented depends upon many factors such as the physical configuration of the drivetrain, powertrain efficiency characteristics, load characteristics, and so on. Operating each individual powertrain in its optimal efficiency region is essential for the overall efficiency of the vehicle. An IC engine generally has the highest efficiency operating region with a wide throttle opening. On the other hand, the efficiency drop in an electric motor is not as detrimental when compared to an IC engine that operates away from its optimal region. I encourage students to study the load power dynamics with respect to time during acceleration, deceleration, and climbing up and down grades by themselves. In case of any doubts, they can contact me. Now moving further, we will look now into the architectures of hybrid vehicles. The classification will be dictated by the connection between the components that define the energy flow routes and control ports. Traditionally, hybrid electric vehicles were classified into only two basic types, series and parallel. Nowadays, they are classified into 4 different kinds, which we will see now. First is series hybrid. Here, the architecture, the key feature is that the two electric powers are added together in the power converter, which functions as an electric power coupler to control the power flows from the batteries and generator to the electric motor, or in the reverse direction, from the electric motor to the batteries. The fuel tank, the IC engine, and the generator constitute the primary energy supply, and the batteries function as an energy bumper. This configuration is called as parallel mechanical coupling configuration. Parallel hybrid drivetrain, in here, two mechanical powers are added together in a mechanical coupler. The IC engine is the primary power plant and the batteries and electric motor drive constitute the energy bumper. The power flows can be controlled only by the power plants, which are the heat engine and the electric motor. Series parallel configuration takes into account the mechanical and electrical coupling, and also there is a complex configuration. The figure on the left side, that is the series parallel hybrid drivetrain, The distinguishing feature of this configuration is the employment of two power couplers. One is the mechanical coupler and one is the power converter, which is the electrical coupler. This configuration is the combination of series and parallel structures and possessing the major features of both and more plentiful operation modes than those of the series or the parallel structure alone. That means it takes into account the electrical coupling part and also the mechanical coupling part of figure 1 and figure 2, the figure in the upper side. On the other hand, it is relatively more complicated and maybe more expensive as compared to only electrical coupling and only mechanical coupling drivetrain. The complex hybrid configuration has a similar structure to the series parallel one. But the only difference is that the electric coupling function is moved from the power converter now to the battery. So the in this configuration, mechanical coupler is there, electrical coupler is also there, but the electric coupler is there in the battery. One more power converter is added between the motor generator and the batteries. Detailed configurations and the components involved will be discussed in detail in the next module. But do note that in a hybrid electric vehicle, there are two kinds of energy flowing in the drivetrain. One is mechanical and one is electrical. Adding two powers together or splitting one power into two at the power merging point always occurs with the same power type, that is electrical or mechanical. It cannot be electrical and mechanical. Perhaps a more accurate definition of hybrid electric vehicle architecture, HEV architecture, may be to take the power coupling or decoupling features such as an electrical coupling drivetrain, a mechanical coupling drivetrain, and a mechanical electrical hybrid coupling drivetrain. These two books are primarily that I have been following and will be followed. In today's lecture, we introduce ourselves to the different configurations and classifications of designing an electric vehicle drivetrain and a hybrid electric vehicle drivetrain. And in order to understand that, we also looked into the limitations of both internal combustion engines and the challenges involved in electric vehicle engine. Thank you so much.